Alright, hey guys, so my project was on 3D or 360 degree cameras. So basically to start off, let's go back to the fundamentals of cameras. The first cameras were basically film cameras, so like Polaroids. And how that works is it's like a film that's very sensitive to light. It's made with silver and like all these other different like chemicals. And so once the film is exposed to light, that's why like it's called like an exposed camera. The different chemicals react to different colors as there's different layers within the film that act to different colors, making a picture. It's kind of complex, but that was the basic idea back in the day. Nowadays, digital cameras, how they work is it's kind of the same process, but instead of being like sensitive to light, it uses lines of code and then transfers that code into pixels. So whenever it feels like it takes the light, it has light receptors, and they turn those light receptors into different zeros and ones. And what happens is that goes through like the computer of the camera, and then the image is made through different pixels. The whole idea behind a 360 degree camera is just the ability to see like 360 degrees vertically and horizontally while you're taking a picture or a film. The idea came back when like the panorama pictures were made. And so one day like people decided, oh, let's take this one step further and make it a complete like panorama just all over the place. So how they work is you have two optic lenses, which are optic wide lenses, sorry, which basically lenses that have a pretty wide field of view. And it can range anywhere from 2 to 8 to 16 lenses, depending on how good you want the quality to be. But for example, this is the cheapest and most like handy dandy, I guess, 360 degree camera. It goes for like $80, and what it is, it composes of two cameras that have 180 degree vision. So naturally, the visions on the 180 degrees, like from your left and your right, are not going to be as good as forward and back, but you still have a cheap and reliable 360 degree camera. And so the applications to this, it can be like I said, to have a more filled picture, you have more information. Also, it can also be used like in dash cams, because sometimes like you have a car accident, but you have a dash cam, but it's like you can't really see more than just what's in front of you.
Alright, so this is an NSA data center, and basically, I mean, if you don't know about the NSA, they track people that seem suspicious and a threat to national security, and they compile data on them about like where they go every day, like what their basic habits are to watch them. So the article I read was about how the NSA created an innovation core to combat hacking. So they got diverse groups of people from everywhere, pretty much, and they had them work together, much like a Shark Tank episode. So they worked together to find a solution to combat the hacking, and they proposed it to like a group of officials, and they picked the best one. And pretty much, like, the reason why you needed to do this is because like technology progresses so quickly that even like the very best like technological officers and security officers that they have to acquire new skills like every day just to keep up with technology. So what they did was they put together a bunch of young people to work together to like combat these things. And like the reason why this is so like relevant and like important to us is because like you never know who's in there, and like the amount of information that they have in there is like very important. So if someone got access to that, they would know your daily whereabouts, like where you shop, how you get to work every day, like whether you take the train. They know whether you're home or not. So like this information has to be very secure, because it has the information of like millions of Americans. So that's why they're putting so much effort into keeping it secure.
So basically what I decided to do, I did some research on Gap, which created a augmented reality. So basically when you go on their website, instead of having to go to the store and try things on, which a lot of people are lazy to do, you can literally, you put in your weight, you put in your height, and they'll give you five different body types to choose from. So you choose from one of those five, and from that they'll show you how it'll fit on that body type. So basically you choose an item and it'll demonstrate how it would look on you. They partnered up with Google Tango and Abrametric, which is a San Francisco based app developer, to create this. So far it's still in pilot mode, it's still in testing. the only ones who are allowed to, who are capable of using it are those who have a Google Tango smartphone or some sort of software. Google Tango is a, it's an augmented reality software, so that's what they, that's what you have to have in order to use this. They're working on making it open to everybody. And so yeah, that's that. There's a difference between, many other people have used virtual reality before in their clothing brands, but this is the first time they've used augmented reality, which uses the actual setting. So that's that, and this is my presentation.
So I found an article about microsensors, and nowadays microsensors are found in a lot of different materials, and they contain metals that are bad for the environment and for human health, so they can't, like, medical products can't use microsensors, and also food products can't use these microsensors. So a scientist named Giovanni Santorini, he's trying to find a way for microsensors to be made with, like, metals that could be used to monitor food temperatures for, like, transporting them, like, across countries. And so he found a way with magnesium and silicon dioxide, and now we could use these little microsensors for, like, transporting fish from, like, Australia or something to, like, a different country that, like, can't get fish, and, like, we could monitor, like, the temperatures and stuff. So it basically brings these food products into a like the Internet of Things, because they're bringing the physical product into, like, these data, whatever, like temperatures and stuff. So these microsensors could be dissolved in 67 days to a saline solution, so it won't stay in the food for as long as 67 days. And that's basically what it looks like inside a cooler. It's, like, super thin, like a little hair, and that's it.
So my article is called Paying With Your Face, written by Will Knight from MIT Technology Review, and it talks about face detecting systems and face recognition. So face recognition identifies a person through images and video sources, which are then implemented into face databases. So a popular system in China called Face++ implements its services into apps in China, such as Alipay, which is a mobile payment app, and Didi, which is a ride-sharing company. So Didi uses a liveness test, which requires a person to speak or move while being scanned to ensure security. And these systems also use a technique called deep learning, which pinpoints certain facial features on a person that can distinguish them. And so not only can these facial recognition systems help, not only can these facial recognition systems help improve technology, they can authorize payments and also ensure security, but they can also raise privacy concerns. This is the Regen Village. It's short for Regenerative Village. It's basically a self-sustained, energy-clean, communal neighborhood. And it's off the grid. It's made for rural locations. And it basically takes the density of cities and it spreads them out into the rural areas using semi-urban lifestyles. So people who don't want to live in the rural areas because they want city life, they can live in these, which has, like, a semi-urban, so you have both city and rural areas. It's self-sustaining, it's very clean for the environment, and it addresses, like, environmental, economic, and social issues. All the houses are energy positive, they have water management, there's energy storage, it's renewable energy only. It's very safe and it's very helpful for the environment. It's first being created in the Netherlands, and then they're expanding out into more European countries such as Switzerland, Germany, Norway, and other countries like Russia. They're expanding into, like, America and, like, South America, China, in the next coming years, but they're trying to see how it works there first because there's less people. Basically, what it is, it's off the grid, and so like they don't have all these issues that the cities have in those areas, and so it basically takes semi-urban living into rural areas.
Okay, so my article's about General Motors and about how they're trying to produce more electric and self-driving cars, and they recently said that they want to shift to completely electric cars and not make any more gas cars in the near future, and they're going to do this by both battery powered cars and by cars by powered by hydrogen fuel cell. And then they're also developing self-driving cars, and they just bought a company based in California that makes LiDAR, which is a system for detecting like where a car is that helps self-driving cars like navigate and go throughout the city.
Hi, I'm Daniel Diaz, and I'd like to present something about kidney dialysis, of something that has been around in the world for about 70 years, but hasn't seen a lot of progress lately. As of recently, a team of medical researchers from UC San Francisco has started developing an implantable artificial kidney using silicon filters that have pores that can only be measured in nanometers, and using cells from other kidneys to reproduce the effect of actual kidneys in a far more efficient way than current kidney dialysis machines do. The problems that have arisen from this, that have arisen with kidney dialysis over the years, is that there's a lot more spent on treating it due to an entitlement from the 70s that allowed everyone to get dialysis if they needed it, which has caused spending in dialysis to reach nearly 50-fold of that of research in kidney disease and ending it. Now this new item is an efficient way to detach people from dialysis and the complications that come from it, and reduce the price tag a lot more as well as the price tag of kidney transplanting.
So General Motors is deciding to switch now, and they recently bought a company called Strobe that specializes in LiDAR sensors, which makes high definition pictures that can be like processed by computers so that it can see like where it's going on the road a lot better. So General Motors is going to add it to like a subsidiary company that they have called Cruise Automation, which is what this is. And so they've already been using them to develop self-driving cars, and they think that Strobe will help them progress a lot faster in doing so.
So my article was about autonomous farming. So these scientists, what they saw was that drones have these GPS trackers, and these ways to manipulate their location and be able to move around. So what they thought was, we have industries in drones as of currently, a lot of photography, and so they have drones to follow you around, take pictures. But they said, what if we have drones to have better agricultural means to produce more food and get more yield out of our harvest? So they got the drones, and they have this technology to implant the chips, on machines, and they're able to move around. So what they thought was, if we get these drones to gather samples from the farms, bring them back so we can study the yields and how the farming is doing, we can send the machines and have these GPS trackers and be able to collect that yield and be able to have the most efficiency out of our farming. So in the UK, they were able to get, the first time in the world, it's 5 tons of spring barley, which is an enormous profit, and they were able to make beer for themselves. And the scientists had challenges being able to get straight lines out of the machines, but now they're saying that with these progresses in drones, we're able to get more food and more farming, therefore have a more successful industry, and they're able to get a lot out of the more outside industries, like the developments of technology, into theirs.